I am going to try to follow the advice of one of the Secretary's predecessors, Lord Redding, who encouraged all speakers to, and I quote, be shorter than anyone dared to hope. That's a great British way of putting it. I was given similar advice from a Baptist preacher friend in my adopted state of Kentucky, who told me similar, in a different way. Remember the fat bees, son. Be brief, brother. Be brief. But thank you so much for letting me be a special part of this special evening. And I want to echo the thanks to the Foreign Secretary, to you, Mr. Robert, to you, Lord Dyson, to the Trust, and to all the members of the 800th Anniversary Committee for your leadership in this momentous year. A year in which we shall attempt to answer definitively Tony Hancock's profound question. We hear quoted so often, does Magna Carta mean nothing to you? Did she die in vain? Contrary to his fears, Magna Carta did not, of course, die and live to inspire future generations, not the least in America. In fact, it was one of my great times spent with my father, John Wilbur. He left his comfortable life in Suffolk, head to the new world, start a new life, and they're seeking him to Boston. And he knew that a stable society is built on fundamental law. So as government organizations, as he called for one that was, quote, in resemblance to an American party. And a century or so on from there, it was a bunch of rabble-rousing colonists in America, some of whom were educated in the law here in England, who, took that idea a few steps further. Perhaps, though, and seriously, Magna Carta found its most significant expression 730 years on from 1918, at the end of World War II, with the discovery of the Nazi process. In 1945, a question came over what the world should do with those responsible. And as you can imagine, there were many loud voices demanding instant retribution, including summary execution. Instead, we, the Allied forces, led by Britain and America, resolved together to put the leaders of Nazi Germany on trial. Think about the magnitude of that decision. To let the rule of law dictate our response to the most grotesque humanitarian death in history. The chief U.S. prosecutor and murderer, Justice Jackson, captured it best, I think, in his now famous quotation, that four great nations, flushed with victory and stunned with injury, stay in the hand of vengeance and voluntarily submit their captive enemies to the judgment of the law, is one of the most significant tributes that power has ever paid. We recognize similar developments in our own time. And the rule of law, and the rule of law always shines above us as a lodestar to our most noble values. Values that, as the former Secretary Leahy pointed out, not only strengthen us, but protect us. President Obama sums it up as follows. Time and again, our values have been our best national security asset in war and peace, in times of ease, and in eras of upheaval. This legacy is what we generally think about when that sacred document is mentioned. It is heavy stuff. It is wonderfully heavy stuff. But, and this is the point I want to emphasize again, there is an even richer aspect to the Magna Carta story. And it's this, that 800 years ago, it was all pretty earthly stuff. Magna Carta is not a favorite. First and foremost, it's a sensible, practical document dealing in concrete remedies for real daily uses. And its officiators, the Scrooge, the escheats, and the disafforestation, I could go on. Maybe there were traces of it, much larger than that. In short, Magna Carta, in its original form, the story around it is a confusing bubbling soup, or mash, if you will, of fermenting anger, distrust, hope, faith, belief, passion, rights, and morals. What we have done through the ages is distill down that mash, little by little, and refine it into its own principles. The legal scholar A.E. J. Howard reminds us of this process in his book on Magna Carta. How we find ourselves saying things today, like, as it says in chapter 39 of Magna Carta, as though they were written in Western order chapters by authors, fully conscious that they were creating. In fact, back then, as you all know, there were no chapters. Not even any Magna Carta. That all came later. And as we see here with the 1297 exemplar of the Guildhall, Magna Carta in the living document, a text through its different iterations, plotted fixed and starts, of our civilization's progress. To me, this messy, herky-jerky, evolutionary story of Magna Carta is just as inspiring and can be a special instructor for us at the time of now. Indeed, this background is nearly as useful as the principles themselves. Consider the conflicts and disputes in today's hotspots around the world. I won't name them, but you can think. Don't you think that we too readily seek only the factions and oppressions, the fermenting of years of hostility and hurt, hatred and murder? As such, we can at times, let's be honest, myself, very much included, get a bit high and mighty. And talk only in abstract terms, in capital letters, safe from our purchase here in capital cities. And sometimes what we see is indeed appalling. But we should probably be quicker to regard these situations with a little more recognition and understanding. Is this all just a toxic brew? Or should we consider the possibility that it is instead the beginning of a distillation process? Without such recognition, it is too easy to throw up our hands and give up our hope when the heavy ideals don't match the earthly reality, the earthly realities. The eternal truth that as the revolution to the crisis you read about fade from the headlines, what is required after is often simply getting down to it, doing the hard, unglamorous work of cutting the deals, correcting the deals, and keeping to them. There are nations right now at the beginning of that process. And with that in mind, we can look around to ourselves at this moment, in this room, and be grateful for being farther along. So, as we leave here tonight, and go forward, as I know we will, and talk enthusiastically about Magna Carta and its commemoration run up to June and beyond. We are right to hold up its essence, this dissonance that we have developed. We are right to preach and to practice those values. We are right to be heavy and not just perfect. As one of my favorite British authors, C.S. Lewis, put it, and he reminds us, aim at heaven, and you will get earth from it. Aim at earth, and you will get me. And so let us be upstanding. This is not in the program. As we raise our glasses in thanks to the parents of 1215, the accidental dysfunctional yet wonderful parents of Magna Carta, to the generations after who distilled their ideas into the cultures, customs, and constitutions we have so fortunately inherited, and to all those engaged today in the hard daily grind of making good on them.